Hey, Mr. Howard, here to record part three of Sir Gawain and the Green Knight. As you can see, I'm outside my house. My son is riding his bike, so if we get interrupted occasionally, it is what it is. He needs his exercise, and I got about an hour during work to record this, so I'm gonna try and kill two birds with one stone. All right. So last time on Sir Gawain and the Green Knight, we read part two. Remember, in part one, Gawain engaged on his quest. The Green Knight showed up and offered this challenge, this test of chivalry, in which Sir Gawain, ended up accepting this deal where he got to swing with an axe at the Green Knight in exchange for the Green Knight being able to swing at him in a year and a day if he survived. He chopped the Green Knight's head clean off, but he didn't die, and he told Gawain to go find him at the Green Chapel, and Gawain had a year to do it. Part two starts, and Gawain is a procrastinator. He holds off until November 1st. And then he goes off on this quest to find the Green Knight. He has all kinds of adventures, which are just sort of mentioned in a montage and a by the way, this happened kind of a thing. And then he prays on Christmas Eve to. Hold on. My son's bike chain just came off his bike. Hey, now that I've fixed a bike chain and my hands are all greasy, let's get back to this lecture. So he prays to the Virgin Mary on Christmas Eve, in the wee hours of the morning, and Shazam, he's granted divine intervention. He arrives at this castle. The castle is ruled by a guy named the Lord, who is married to the lady, and he's able to spend his Christmas season there. And so part two takes us up until December 28th, I believe, when he's got the 29th, 30th, and 31st, and then on the 1st, he's going to go face the Green Knight and get his head chopped off. Some interesting things come out of this, though. Gawain meets the lady, the wife of the Lord, and clearly he is incredibly attracted to her, and she seems to be quite attracted to him. The description of her is more beautiful than Guinevere in Gawain's eyes, which says that he thinks she's the most attractive woman in the world. Also, the Lord is boisterous and cheerful and enjoys sort of challenging Gawain, because Gawain comes from King Arthur's court. He's interested to see how great Gawain is, and so they all get drunk, and he offers this weird game where he's going to go out hunting, and Gawain's going to stay in the castle with his wife, and whatever he earns hunting, he's going to give to Gawain, and whatever Gawain earns in the castle, which would be stuff that belongs to the Lord anyway, he's got to give to the Lord. So it's sort of a strange sort of deal, but they drink to it and agree, and they do this because the host or the Lord has told Gawain that he knows where the Green Chapel is, and so he can help Gawain be successful on his quest. And so Gawain is sort of trapped in this situation where he's got to do what the Lord wants, because the Lord is his ticket to completing the quest that he left Camelot to go on to, even though the quest is his own death. So we're going to start part three. Remember that each of these three parts is sort of symbolic of a season, and the seasons are symbolic of the human life cycle. So we've gone through sort of birth, which is spring, and maturity or growing, which is summer, and now we're at fall, which is sort of metaphorically old age. It's that time when we, for the first time in our lives, start to be concerned about the idea of death. And the impending end and those sorts of things. And so Gawain has left the comfort of his home, of the place where he grew up, and now he is traveling the world trying to have this meeting with the Green Knight, who is going to bring him death, which is sort of the inevitable conclusion of all of our lives, the inevitable conclusion of all of our quests, metaphorically speaking. So we're going to do part three. We're going to pick up where we left off last time and see what we get. Long before dawn, the castle woke. Departing guests called for their grooms, and men came running, saddles in hand, and tied up their gear and packed their bags. This is the end of the 12 days of Christmas, which starts before Christmas but ends like the 28th, 3 days before New Year's. Remember, Arthur had 15, so his celebrations were still going on New Year's Day, going back to the beginning of the story. And men came running, saddles in hand, and tied up their gear and packed their bags. And guests came ready to ride, and leaped onto their horses and shook the reins and rode where they wanted, each to his home. The last one ready. Hold on, I gotta pause this and fix the margins. You're not gonna be able to see the bottom of the page. My mouse has gotten lost. All right, there it is. Come on. and leaped on their horses, shook the reins, and rode where they wanted, each to his home. And the well-loved lord of that castle was not the last one ready. He and his men, after a mass, he ate a hasty meal, and blowing his bugle, doo-doo-doo, galloped to the hunt. He and his knights were set in their saddles before the sunlight gleamed. Huntsmen leashed up hounds, opened kennel doors, and called out dogs, blaring long notes and loud on their horns. And beagles bayed and barked and snarled and were whipped and shouted back when they strayed. Aside 100 wonderful hunters, they tell me, and keepers took up places, and dogs ran free, and the forest swelled with horns and hooves and chases. So we get the lord starting his hunt that he's been all excited about. And, you know, he's out with his dogs early in the morning. We're going to have a real description of the hunt and how it goes. And some of this is old medieval stuff that's going to need a little bit of explanation. So at the cry of the hounds, wild animals shook. Dazed deer in the valleys bolted for the hill. So the deer have no idea that the hunt's coming. And all of a sudden they hear the hounds coming. And they're like, oh gosh. And they bolted for the hills. The hills sort of represent safety in this case. And they were shut in the woods by a shouting ring of beaters. Pause. We don't hunt this way anymore. We hunt in a way that I guess we would say is much more fair. It's one guy with a gun against the deer. But back in the old days, you'd have these servants, and they'd be called beaters, and they'd have sticks, and they'd surround the woods, and they'd all walk towards the center, like knocking on bushes and things with their clubs, and it would basically force all the deer into what is essentially sort of like a bait ball in the middle of the forest, so they could be easily hunted down by the men with bows. And then they would take all of this meat, and they would fix it and salt it, and they would have meat for the winter. It was sort of a seasonal thing that was done by lords, you know, on their castles. And so you would be aware of this if it was the Middle Ages. So these beaters are coming in, knocking on the branches and stuff and scaring the deer into the center. Let's see. Stags with arching antlers were allowed through the gates, and flat-horned big bucks, for that noble lord had ordered that the law of the season be observed, and no man touch a male deer. So it turns out that male deer are let out through the beaters because it's doe season. It's like the season when they kill female deer, not male deer. And so the male deer with the antlers are free to go. But the hinds, they hallooed back. Hey, hey, watch out. And they drove does deeper into valleys, and arrows slanted down, great broad arrows flying at every turn, cutting deep in brown hides. Ha! They screamed and bled, and high on the slopes they died, hounds hurrying after them, and hunters with horns blowing, so hard that the echoes seemed to crack cliffs. And the deer that escaped arrows were caught by keepers, cut down and killed, hunted back from the safety of the high ground. These men all knew their trade. And their greyhounds were so huge that leaping on a deer from behind, they tore him down right there, as fast as the telling. And frantic with delight, the lord rode and yelled and ran till night and darkness fell. So that's what the lord's up to. And now we have an interesting literary technique, which is new. People haven't really done this in writing before. We have a meanwhile. So that's what the lord's doing all day. He's out there hunting. Meanwhile, we're going to shift into the castle. So the lord plays at the edge of the woods, and Gawain lies in a lovely bed, quiet until daylight comes creeping up the walls and over the coverlet and around the curtain. So it's a nice personification. If you've ever lying in a bed as the sun rises, you can see the sun rise up the walls. That's what he's going for here. And over the coverlet and around the curtains. One other thing I guess you should know is that in medieval times, beds were different. They had these big four-poster beds, and the beds had curtains all around them, sort of walling you in. This was to help keep the warmth in. They didn't have the insulation that they have now. They didn't have the heating systems that they had now. You would have a fireplace, and you'd light a fire maybe before you went to bed, but the fire would burn down, and so your room would become very cold. And so you'd want your own blankets, but you'd want to keep the privacy and the warmth of the curtained bedchamber. Gawain's inside a curtain bed. Let's see. And sleeping in peace, he heard suddenly a noise at his door, and he heard it swing too, and pulling his head from the pillow, he parted the edge of the curtain and peered carefully out, wondering who had entered. The lady of that castle, beautiful to watch, silently shut the door behind her and approached the bed. All right, this is an awkward situation. Gawain is sleeping in the morning, and he hears the door of his room open and close, and he peeks out the corner of the bed, and he sees the lord's wife, the lady of the castle, in his room. Like, this is improper. People aren't supposed to do this, and he's like, what? And so should you be. You should be like, what? You know, it's like if you were, I don't know, if you were, you know, at some sort of a party at your boss's house, and then it like snowed overnight and you couldn't leave, so they gave you the guest room to sleep in, and he went off to a meeting in the morning, and all of a sudden his wife's sneaking into your room. This is sort of the situation that Gawain finds himself in. Remember, this is a chivalrous knight, and there's elements of chivalry that are at play, and Gawain is supposed to be holding true to his vow. Anyway, and Gawain, embarrassed, dropped his head and pretended to close his eyes. So he's like, maybe if I pretend to be asleep, she'll leave me alone. And the lady came nearer and quietly lifted the curtain and softly entered and gently sat at the edge of the bed and waited and watched for Gawain to awake. It just got even more awkward. Not only did she come into his room unannounced, but now she came into his curtain bed and is sitting on the bed watching him sleep. And he kept her waiting, hiding his head, wondering why she had come and what she meant to do. He thought it a strange adventure indeed, but he said to himself, "Better to ask and know than hide and sleep." So he tossed and stretched and turned toward her and opened his eyes and played at surprise and crossed himself as though to bless his words. Her face was sweet. Her skin was white and pink. She spoke like birds singing and her small lips laughed. So, he's laying there pretending to be asleep, trying to avoid interaction with her, and she's just staying there. And so eventually he just sort of gives up and is like, all right, well, I'm gonna pretend that I was asleep. So he's like, oh my gosh, right? Like, and he pretends that he's surprised to see her there, and they talk to each other, and her description, her face was sweet. That's a weird metaphor, you know, a face can't be sweet. Sweet is like a flavor. Her skin was white and pink. She spoke like birds singing. That's a simile, you know, and she's cheerful and happy. "Good morning, Gawain," said that beautiful woman. Your sleep is so innocent that anyone can catch you. And now you're caught. If no one arranges a truce, I'll tie you to your bed, I will." Wait, what? Yeah, you read that right. I don't know what exactly she's threatening here, but she's definitely using the language of the hunt. She's trapped him. He's tied up. And Gawain, you know, like, she's another guy's wife, and that guy happens to be his host, and purity is one of the rules of chivalry, and you know, so, as is honorably treating the host himself, as is, you know, thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's wife, which goes back to faith. So, like, he's got a lot of reasons to be nervous here. Where was I? Laughing, she teased him with a flurry of words. "Good morning, lady," said Gawain gaily. Aha. No, it just means happy. "Whatever you please will please your servant here. I surrender at once. I beg for mercy, the best I can hope for now." And he laughed with her as they juggled words. "My lovely captor, release me a moment. Order me to rise and dress more properly so that I can leave this bed as I'd like to do. And a walking night would please you more." So Gawain, you know, he tries to be pleasant. He tries to be nice about this. And he asks, you know, if he can get up and change. He's like, "You have me at a disadvantage. I'm in my PJs. Can I get up and go get changed?" And we'll see what she says here. Let's see. "Good sir," said that lovely, "stay where you are. You're not to rise. I have better plans." Okay. "I'll lock you where you lie, and sit where I am, and then I can talk to this knight I've caught, for I know who you are. Gawain himself, honored all over the world. I've heard them praise your perfect chivalry, pure to lords, to ladies, to everyone alive. And here you are. And we're alone. My lord and his men away in the woods. All men asleep, and my maids too. Your door shut and locked with a bolt." Hold up, wait. Not only did she come into his room, but she, like, locked the door behind her? And this whole speech is leading up to something here. You know, like, my husband's away in the woods with all of his men. Everybody's asleep, and we're here alone. It's only sunrise, you know. Anyway. "And having in my house a man so loved, I refuse to waste my chance for as long as it lasts. Now please us both. Decide our path. Your arms are too strong. I bow to your force." That's an unfortunate quatrain. What is she saying here? Please us both decide our path. Your arms are too strong. I bow to your force. What's the translation here? Like, we're all alone and my husband's nowhere around and I couldn't stop you if I wanted to and I don't. Right? Like, what? So this, but question, did she ask him for anything? Remember, courtesy says that whatever a lady asks you to do as a knight, you're supposed to do that. But does she actually ask for anything here? She leaves the decision entirely up to him. We'll see how Gawain responds. Remember, she's the hottest woman in the world. And let's complicate this. Gawain's going to die in 3 days. So put yourself in his situation. What would you do here? Lord, said Gawain, how lucky I am, lady, not to be the knight you speak of. To take that kind of honor for my own would be sinful. I know myself too well. By God, I'd be glad if it pleased you to offer you some different service in word or deed. To serve such excellence would be endless delight. So he's very polite to her, but he essentially is like, yeah, I'm not going to do that. He's like, thank God I'm not a rapist, right? Like, you can sort of see that in the beginning of his statement. And interesting, he says Lord at the beginning. Is that a call out to God? I think so. Or is it a call out to her husband? Maybe it's that too. So it's an interesting situation there. Let's see how she responds. You own such excellence. No, wait, sorry. Indeed, Sir Gawain, said that lovely lady, you own such excellence, such surpassing power, that to slight your ability would be a lack of breeding. How many women there are, my gentle knight, who'd rather hold you in their castles as I hold you here, and hear your courteous voice, and comfort their sorrows, and cool their grief, than keep their golden treasure. Wait. What? Let's translate that again. What is she saying here? She's saying, oh, you're so perfect, Gawain. She wanted to get the word breeding in there, I think. I think there's innuendo all through here. But she's like, how many women there are, my gentle knight, who'd rather hold you in their castles as I hold you here, and hear your courteous voice, and comfort their sorrows, and cool their grief, than keep their golden treasure? Translation, there's a lot of women who would pay for this opportunity. Is she sort of between the lines offering to pay Gawain for this, you know, experience? I think maybe she is, but you can note that Gawain does not respond at this point. He lets her keep talking. And so she changes sort of her tone a little bit here. She says, my love for our Lord who rules in heaven restrains me, though his grace has given me what all women want. What all women want, of course, is Gawain. And she has him, and she's like, but thank goodness I'm a good girl, right? And I believe in God, right? And so she invokes faith here. She spoke so well and looked so well that Gawain gave her honest answers free of cant. Madam, said that noble, modest man, may Mary reward you. Your noble words, like many men's deeds, assign me honor and virtue that, in fact, I've never deserved. Indeed, when you speak such perfection, you speak of yourself. So smooth. He's like, oh, my lady, you say I'm perfect, but the only perfect one here is you. How smooth is that? But he's supposed to be smooth. He's supposed to be chivalrous and courtly and all those kinds of things. By Mary, said that wonderful woman, no, even if I were worth all women alive, held all the wealth of the world in my hands, if I had the choice of a husband. Ah, knight, I found you out, and now for your beauty, your grace, your cheerful ways, exactly what I heard you were, nothing and no one on earth could come before you. Okay, so again, let's translate what the lady says here. She says, if I had all the money of all the women on earth, and then I had the choice of a husband, I would choose you. So she's like, you know, if I could choose my husband, I had to marry this guy. But if I could choose my husband, I would choose you. And that kind of makes us married, right? Okay. But then she goes on and she says, you know, you're so perfect. You're so perfect that nothing and no one on earth could come before you, which implies that she likes him better than anyone else, including her husband. It's obvious with no one on earth that she's excluding her husband from this. So it's an interesting situation that our guy Gawain is in. Let's see how he responds to that. Thank God, said Gawain, your choice was better. But I'm proud to be priced so high in your eyes, for you are my queen, and I your servant, and your knight. May Christ repay you, lady. Till the middle of the morning they spoke of many things. The lady pretending to love him, Gawain was cautious, walked with care and tact. "Were I the most beautiful on earth," she thought, "his heart would hang slack, thinking of the reason for this journey and the blow this season will bring him." So she is sure that she could seduce Gawain if it wasn't for the fact that he was going to die in 3 days. Somehow she thinks that the reason he's not into her is because he's thinking about the fact that he's going to have his head chopped off in 3 days, and that's occupying his thoughts and keeping his mind off romance. At least that's the excuse she seems to give him. And knowing it was time, she took her leave. But saying farewell, looking back with a laugh, she suddenly stunned him. "By him who blesses our speech, repay me. If Gawain were Gawain, he'd settle his debt." "For what?" he asked quickly, afraid that he'd failed to frame some suitable phrase. So she turns around as she's leaving, and she stuns him with this thing like, "You have been rude," is essentially what she says. And he's responsible to be courteous, especially to ladies at all time. That's part of his vow of chivalry. And so he's afraid that somehow he's insulted her. He has not, she's never asked him for anything to this point, so he hasn't really done anything wrong, but he's afraid that somehow he's ruined his chivalry. And her response is, "By him who blesses our speech, repay me. If Gawain were Gawain, he'd settle his debt." "For what?" he asked, afraid that he'd failed to frame some suitable phrase. But she smiled and wished him well. "Because," she explained, "if Gawain were as good as his name, with every courtly virtue lining his heart, he'd never have stayed so long with a lady and left her unkissed. Courtesy cries out against him. Surely some sly word was missing." So her answer is, "You were rude to me because you've been alone with me for all this time and you haven't kissed me." It's rude when you're alone with a lady not to kiss her. And so that's her statement. And this is the closest she's come to asking for something. Let's see how Gawain responds. "Your pleasure is my command, lady. I kiss as you wish, as a good knight must. Ask me only once." She walked toward the bed, wound her arms around him, bent to his face, and kissed him. So she gets a kiss out of him because she asks for it. And as a knight, this is a tricky thing for him. Remember, we said it was a challenge of chivalry, and this is the theme of this is chivalry. Is it chivalrous to kiss another man's wife if she asks for it? This is a tricky thing. Maybe you want to throw your answer down there in the comments below, or maybe I'll have a quick, class discussion where we can debate this point. He gives her the kiss because she asked for it. Is it breaking purity? Has he done anything wrong? Is it breaking honor? Has he done anything wrong? How do we weigh the importance of these things? And if you don't want it, is it bad? I mean, like, he thinks she's pretty, but does he really desire this kiss? I don't know. It's worth considering. It's worth thinking about. Let's see. She walked toward the bed, wound her arms around him, bent to his face and kissed him. With flowing words, they commended each other to Christ. She closed his door behind her, silent, and Gawain swiftly rose, called to his man, chose his clothes, and was dressed, then walked happily to mass. First thing he does is go to church. And was to the worthy meal that was waiting. And then all day, till the moon shone, made merry. No better host sported with a man. Every moment the young lady and the old made laughter roll. Now we transition again back to the hunt. And the Lord reveled in his own pleasure, hunting deer in the meadows and woods. Before the sun sank down, he'd killed so many no one could count them. Huntsmen and keepers came together proud and quickly collected the bodies in a pile. And the noblest knights, with their men around them, chose the sleekest deer for themselves, ordered them neatly quartered and carved. When they sliced the animals and measured them, the leanest and thinnest was 2 inches thick with fat. Now we're going to get this extraordinarily detailed description of how these animals are processed in medieval times. It seems weird and out of place, but remember all the detail we gave to the Green Knight and his appearance and all the detail we gave to Gawain's shield. We're going to go into a similar amount of detail on the correct way to cut up and process a dead deer in medieval times. Apologies to those of you who are squeamish or vegetarians or vegans. It is what it is. I got to read the story. And if you're a hunter and you want to know how to process a deer, boom, this can be your instruction manual. Let's see. First, the throat was slit and the gullet scraped with a sharp knife and tied. Then they cut the legs and skinned them, then broke the belly open and carefully hauled out the intestines, leaving the gullet knotted in place. Then taking the throat, they quickly separated the esophagus and windpipe and hung out the guts, then carved the shoulder bone loose, pulled through a small slit and kept the hide whole. Then they cut the breast in halves and started to cut at the throat. They ripped the carcass to where the front legs fork, emptied the edible guts, then cut away the membranes around the ribs. They carved along the backbone, down to the haunches so that the meat held together, then lifted it up all at once and cut it at the end, properly called the nubbles, I know. And the folds of the hind legs and the meat of those bones were quickly cut and the spine laid open. Then they cut off the head and cut off the neck and carved the flanks away from the spine and threw the raven's fee in the thicket. Then they ran a hole through the ribs and hung the carcasses by the hind legs, each taking the parts proper to his rank. They set out liver and lungs and tripe on a fresh flayed skin mixed with bread soaked in blood to feed their hounds. Then hunting horns blared, doo-doo-doo, and dogs bayed as taking their venison, hunters turned home to high staccato bugling loud and clear. By sunset, they had come to that castle, and there was Gawain quietly waiting near a bright fire at peace. So we have the end of the hunting day. The Lord has killed a lot of deer. He's you know, processed them, if you will, perfectly. And one of the things that I think is interesting here, though, if you read the processing of the deer details carefully, one of the details is that they cut off all of the heads. So one of the things that the Lord comes in with all of his winnings, all of the deer that he killed, is that there's a parade of severed deer heads, which, of course, if you put yourself in Gawain's shoes and he's going to have his head cut off in now 2 days, you know, like how would you feel? I think that's one of those interesting things that if you read the story a few times, you start to sort of pick up on. But now they've come back. And so Gawain and the Lord are going to meet here in the hall. Let's see. Near a bright fire at peace. The Lord came to that night joyful, and they greeted each other with delight. And the Lord ordered all the household to his hall. Both of the ladies came with their maids. And when everyone had gathered, he commanded that his men bring his venison to him. And he turned to Gawain with a gracious laugh, asking that he note the bushy tails of the noble deer. And he showed the bright flesh from their ribs. Does it please you, this sport? Have I earned your praise? Have I won appreciation with my skill? Most certainly, said the knight. These are the best game that I've seen in 7 winters. Ah, 7, the number of purity. Gawain seems to be indicating that he stayed pure. It's yours, Gawain, said the Lord. Our agreement lets you claim it as your own. You are right, said the knight. And I say the same, for here in this house I have won a worthy prize, one that I am proud to make yours. Wait, what? What prize did Gawain win in the castle? Remember the terms of their game. He's going to get whatever the Lord wins, and the Lord's going to get whatever he wins. He put his arms around the Lord's neck and kissed him as courteously as a knight could. Here are my winnings. I won no more. I would give it gladly were there more to give. Wait, what? Anyway, so he kisses the Lord because he won a kiss. So Gawain did win something in this situation. Now, I love this next exchange. I am pleased, said the Lord, and I thank you. Perhaps your winnings are the best, and perhaps you can tell me just where your skill won you this prize. So the Lord's like, and who's the lucky lady, eh? Right, and of course this is super awkward for Gawain because the lucky lady is the Lord's wife. you know, the author has put us in this ridiculous situation. I love it. I'm here for it. No, said Gawain, and we said nothing of that. You had what I owe you, and there's nothing more to claim. So Gawain's like, I don't kiss and tell. But of course, you know the real reason he's not telling. They laughed and were gay. Means happy. And exchanged sweet words. And again, they sat to supper and ate famously. And then they sat by a fire in a private room. This is with the ladies, of course. And the best of wines were brought to them. And again, as they sought their beds, they agreed to make the same bargain for another morning. Whatever their winnings, they'd exchange them in the evening when they met once more. Everyone in that court heard their vows. They drank one final toast, laughing, and took leave of each other, gracious to the end. And both hurried to their beds. When the cock had crowed, actually, we're gonna stop there. We're at about 30 minutes. It's a good stopping place. So they make an agreement for the second day, and it's going to be the same as the first day. Whatever the Lord wins out hunting, he's going to give to Gawain, and whatever Gawain wins, he's going to give to the Lord. Interesting. we're gonna stop here, and I gotta record a second video for you, but I need outside aid, so I gotta make some notes for you before I talk about that one. So I hope you enjoyed this. We'll pick back up at line 14, 11 next time. Thanks.